My name is Justin Terrell, and I'm the Executive Director of the Minnesota Justice Research Center. Thank you for joining us for this brief webinar on our latest report, Accountability in Policing, the Unexplored Power of the Post Board. The Minnesota Justice Research Center is a nonprofit focused on transforming the criminal legal system. Our tools that we use to do that are research, education, and policy development. And our goal is to equip communities with what they need in order to bring the system into alignment with the commonly held values that we share across our state. It's been 2 years since the murder of George Floyd, and we are wrestling with two basic questions. Do we try to wait out this moment of tension and let things go back to the way they were? Or do we seize this opportunity to do the work to transform the profession of law enforcement to be more effective, more humane, and to operate with the people's trust? Today, we're going to look at the role of accountability, a relational concept that we've heard people talk a lot about in the last 2 years. And I'm excited about this report as it follows up on our previous report about white supremacy and the role of trust in law enforcement. Chris Robertson is here with us today. Chris is a PhD candidate at the University of Minnesota Sociology School. And is one of our brilliant research assistants who has helped author this report. I'll hand it over to Chris now to walk you through what we've learned. Thank you, Chris.
Thank you so much, Justin, for that introduction. Hello, my name is Chris Robertson, and I am a research assistant with the MNJRC. Each year, the MNJRC releases a research report that examines how Minnesota's current legal system lives up to a community value. This year, we are prioritizing the value of accountability in respect to policing. Today, I'll be providing an overview of our latest research report, Accountability in Policing, the Unexplored Power of the Post Board. So first, why focus on accountability? As Justin eloquently spoke to, in a previous report, we examined trust as a value in relation to policing. We held conversations with community members, policymakers, scholars, and members of law enforcement about the role of white supremacy in policing and how and whether communities of color might ever trust our state's current law enforcement system. One thing we heard consistently was that trust cannot be built without true accountability, especially in instances of violent misconduct or unjustifiable use of force policy, or use of force by police officers. Local research also finds the same thing. In addition, true accountability must be sustained long-term for trust to develop. So this year, we have decided to focus on the value of accountability in relation to policing. To better understand police accountability in Minnesota, we first explore what police accountability means, especially in the case of use of force misconduct. Second, we examine what accountability looks like now in Minnesota. We do this by describing the institutions, policies, and practices that hold individual police officers accountable for the appropriate use of force in Minnesota. Third, we analyze data on how well our current accountability systems work in preventing or disciplining the excessive or unjustified use of force. And then finally, we provide recommendations for improving police accountability systems in Minnesota. In the first part of our analysis, we examined accountability as a value. What does it mean to be accountable? The definition we use written here is that to be accountable is to be obligated via procedure or policies or willing as an individual to accept responsibility and to account for one's actions. Accountability always requires systems and individuals to take on some level of responsibility. It also requires a set of procedures and policies that support the process of taking responsibility. While both departments and individual police officers can be held accountable, In this report, we focus on the systems that hold individual officers accountable for engaging in conduct that protects and serves the community in a specific way, namely without using excessive and unjustifiable force. We focus on use of force in part because the limited data shows vast disparities in use of force cases for Black and Indigenous populations. In 2015, of the approximately 1,100 killings by police in the US, Black and Indigenous people were killed at a rate twice their share in the population. Similarly, high racial disparities exist for non-deadly use of force instances as well. So, how are individual police officers held accountable for protecting and serving communities without the use of force, use of excessive and unjustified force currently? A first step in this analysis is to figure out what types of systems, policies, or practices involving accountability exist and where those systems, policies, and practices live. This slide shows an image of what we call an accountability axis. This axis represents several intersecting dimensions of accountability as identified by leading scholars in the field of police accountability. Along the horizontal dimension, this axis shows that accountability mechanisms include both back-end and front-end procedures. Front-end procedures refer to the standards of conduct that we hold officers to. These are both internal and external, internal being internal to the police department, external being standards that are that exist outside of the police department. So for instance, an external standard would be the standards imposed by the Minnesota Post Board or state laws, whereas internal front-end standards would be the use of force policies and departmental policies around what police officers can and can't do when during an encounter with someone on the street. Back-end procedures are typically what we think of when we think about accountability, the consequences for violating our standards, violating those policies, violating state laws. So you can think of these, and these again also are internal and external. So internally, a back-end procedure would be the department investigation into a complaint of officer misconduct that has been filed by a citizen. Or an external back-end accountability mechanism would be the courts, the convening of grand juries, an officer going to face criminal charges. Again, external, and since it's seeking to hold an officer accountable for violating a front-end accountability mechanism, a standard, it would lie in the back-end part of this axis. And so what are the current accountability systems in Minnesota for law enforcement officers? As we argue, we find in Minnesota, these systems of accountability are vague and rely primarily on police departments policing themselves. Our report goes into considerable detail on the policies and statutes that set standards for how officers carry out their work, as well as those back-end procedures and administrative or judicial procedures that are activated if and when misconduct occurs. For example, I'll just provide two examples. In Duluth, front-end policies around use of force are governed by an objective reasonable standard, which is the amount of force that a reasonable officer at the scene would have used based upon the facts known at the time of the incident that is consistent with training, state law, and departmental policy. On the back end, in Minneapolis, for example, the decision maker about if, when, and how to discipline an officer for misconduct lies with the chief of police. Again, police policing themselves. But interestingly, Minnesota does have a state-level body originally designed to hold peace officers accountable through its licensing authority. This agency is the Minnesota Peace Officer Standards and Training, also known as the POST Board. The POST Board was the first law enforcement occupational licensing system in the U.S. The POST Board is an executive branch state agency that regulates licensing and training standards for nearly 12,000 peace officers in Minnesota. The POST Board is managed and led by 17 governor-appointed members representing a diverse set of stakeholders from both law enforcement and the community. Returning to our accountability axis, we can see that to locate where the place board or the POST Board plays in police accountability, we can see that the POST Board holds authority for both front-end standards and back-end consequences through the creation of model departmental policies and through the suspension or revocation of individual officers' licenses. As an authoritative body, the POST Board has the capacity to create model policies for department across the state to adopt and recommend changes to the language of state statutes. In addition, the POST Board holds the power to shape the back-end accountability structures. It has the authority to address both departmental and criminal misconduct allegations and circumvents some of the challenges that face other systems within our current police accountability framework. However, when we turn to the data, we find limited evidence that any of these systems, including the POST Board, are ensuring that officers are held accountable for appropriate use of force at either the front or the back end. It is important to note that while we review the publicly available data that exists on how accountability structures function, overall, the public has minimal access to statewide data on police accountability. Our review of the evidence was based on scattered and often unclear data from departments and the state where available. For example, this chart shows statewide data on police misconduct allegations available through the POST Board's website. We see here a total of 755 investigations were reportedly launched by departments just around incidences categorized as use of force violations in 2016 to 2020. As the chart's red line shows, this equates to an average of about 150 use of force investigations per year across the state. Of those 755 investigations, 70% were categorized as violations of departmental policy related to the use of force. And this is shown by the middle light blue line on the chart. And the remaining 30%, which is indicated by the dark blue line at the bottom of the chart, were criminal convictions or alleged criminal misconduct related to the use of force. In total, this indicates that there are a high number of use of force complaints. Just 10% of these use of force investigation complaints in Minnesota were sustained, which means that officers were found to have violated existing use of force policies, while 68% were either not sustained or exonerated. Approximately 22% of these investigations were left as pending each year. Certainly, there are complaints that are unfounded, but the system's current pattern of holding officers accountable in 1 out of 10 use of force allegations suggests that our police accountability mechanisms are missing the mark. Finally, this slide shows the outcomes of cases involving lethal force by an officer. State level data shows that from 2013 to 2021, police officers in Minnesota killed 107 people, but over half, approximately 63% of these incidents remain unreported or pending investigation. Of the 107 incidents, 5% of the officers were charged, and 3 of the 5% were convicted. On the other end, 32% of these police killings were ruled as justified or cleared by a grand jury. And to date, despite having the authority to do so, the Post Board has not effectively used its disciplinary authority to hold officers accountable. Nationally, Minnesota's license revocation rate ranks among the bottom of the 47 states that license peace officers. For example, from 2015 to 2019, Georgia decertified, meaning it took away the licenses of 3,239 officers, while Minnesota decertified 21. In fact, since 1981, the Post Board has only revoked the licenses of a total of 167 officers. This analysis, both of the structures that support police accountability and a review of the limited evidence available, leads to our main finding. The limited data at the department and state level on complaints, outcomes of investigations, and discipline of misconduct show that internal department and external state and oversight mechanisms of accountability are complex, ineffective, and convoluted. So, how do we improve on these systems of accountability? Given its authority to hold officers accountable, both at the front end through the creation of model policies and standards of conduct, as well as the back end through licensing revocation and suspension, we center our recommendations on the Post Board. Our report recommends the following. First, collect more and better data. Many of the policies and procedures in place to hold law enforcement officers accountable require data collection. The Post Board can begin this process of improving data quality and transparency. Research shows the collection and analysis of data on use of force by law enforcement can help to further accountability and improve community relations and trust. Second, increase community outreach at the Post Board. Since the Post Board is an integral part of the state's broader set of systems of police accountability. Given this, we recommend that the Post Board incorporate efforts to educate the community about its mission, role, and authority, and to listen to and learn from community members. In August 2020, the Post Board began an important rules overhaul and sought to engage with the community in this process. However, these efforts were not well publicized, which limited public engagement. Moving forward, the Post Board must develop more effective methods for engaging the community, especially Black and Brown community members and others who are most directly impacted by police misconduct. Third, adopt recent rule changes to strengthen accountability at the Post Board. As of May 5th, 2022, the Post Board approved a new rules draft. The approved rule changes allow the Post Board to better align its scope of authority with Minnesota statutes. If the Post Board approves the recently proposed changes, it will increase its ability to hold individual officers accountable for performing core law enforcement duties in a manner that protects and serves the needs of the community. Fourth, include both specific and general language in standards of conduct. To achieve accountability through licensing, research suggests that the standards of conduct must include both specific and general language. Standards of conduct that are too specific increase the risk that officers' legal representation can maneuver the complaint around the scope of the post board's oversight. On the other hand, language that is overly broad likely would create vague and ambiguous standards that could lead to inconsistent enforcement. Fifth, adequately staff and fund the post board. Increasing the political will of the post board to use licensure to hold officers accountable will require an organizational investment that will ensure that the post board has the staffing and resources needed to investigate and address instances of misconduct effectively. Thank you for your time today. We encourage you to check out our full report, which you can find at our website, mnjrc.org. Now I want to kick it back to Justin to close us out.
Thank you, Chris, for that in-depth discussion of our most recent report. And thank you to everyone who has watched this webinar, who is sharing this webinar. We hope that it's an educational tool that helps you understand an option to build accountability for the law enforcement profession, which serves all of our communities. And if you're interested in doing more than just reading our report or watching this webinar, feel free to visit our website, mnjrc.org, where you can download a toolkit that has instructions on how to provide public comment to the post board, as they are currently going through a process of receiving public comment while they overhaul the standards of conduct that govern the rules of every officer's license in the state of Minnesota. We are happy to provide this resource, and we hope and pray that you take advantage of it, because everyone needs to add their voice to what the future of law enforcement in our state looks like. Thank you for your time. Thank you for caring about this issue. Please look out for your loved ones and continue to add your name and your call for justice to the struggle. Take care.